oceans apart, day after day, and I slowly go insane. I hear your voice on the line, but it doesn't stop the pain. If I see you next to never, then how can we say forever? Wherever you go, whatever you do, I will be right here waiting for you. Whatever it takes, or how my heart breaks, I will be right here waiting for you. I took for granted all the times that I thought would last somehow. I hear the laughter, I taste the tears, but I can't get near you now. Oh, can't you see it, baby? You've got me going.
We're so excited to tell you that at this moment, we have near 1,400 participants from 85 countries and 6 continents around the world.
That today, we have near 1,000 participants from 53 countries across 6 continents.
We are so excited to inform you that at this very moment, we have more than 1,000 participants from 76 countries across 6 continents.
And today we are so excited to inform you that at this very point we have more than 1,100 participants from 71 countries across 6 continents streaming from both Zoom and YouTube.
Time is yours. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, lift off.
Thank you very much. It's been a great pleasure to speak with you. Nice to meet you over Zoom. It's interesting that we meet people now across the world all the time.
And lift off. Give applause to Amar Agarwal.
Thank you very, very much, first of all, to entire Indonesia and also to all the 1,400 delegates watching from 85 countries.
Oh, applause. God speaks my jealousy.
Thank you very much for this extremely kind invitation and of course a very beautiful
introduction.
Thank you very much. It was quite amazing.
Time is yours. Leave off. Ahead, please.
Thank you very much. First of all, I want to thank Gede, Parlianto and all Indonesian ophthalmologists that were being so kind to invite me.
Thank you so much, really, for organizing something like this, because it really kind of opens up so many channels of education.
Thank you very much for the very kind invitation and how many international respondents you have. You obviously, the whole world is watching Indonesia.
4, 3, 2, 1, time is yours. Leave off. Here we go, Devin. It is showtime.
Thank you all, and everyone be safe, and I hope all of you around the world think how many people you reach with this. It's great. It's a great service. Anyway, you're doing a great job. My congratulations to everyone.
Thank you.
All right, I think we are ready to begin. So, hello everyone, good morning and happy spring equinox to all the honorable doctors participating at this webinar, especially for the audiences who are in Indonesia and in Asia. So good morning to all of you and good evening for those who may be in other time zones, such as in the United States, like where I am. And good morning too for our special guest for today, the Maestro Professor Takayuki Akahoshi from Tokyo, Japan. Hello, Professor. Konnichiwa, Sensei.
Konnichiwa. Good morning.
Good morning.
It's 11 o'clock in the morning. This is my first webinar using Zoom.
I see.
Works well.
Yes, we are definitely looking forward to it as well. So yeah, we will be beginning shortly. First of all, allow me to introduce myself. My name is Fira Fatmasifa. I am an astrophysics student in UC Berkeley. And allow me to host and guide the webinar series for this time. This is the 8th edition of the 1 Hour with the Maestro webinar series. And it is also the 3rd one that we're having in the year of 2021. And of course, we are very, very happy to see all of you again at this webinar series. So first, we would like to thank the Sabang Merauke Eye Center, and we'd also like to thank the Indonesian Ophthalmologist Association North Sumatra Branch, as well as the Indonesian Doctor Association North Sumatra Branch for supporting this event. So we are very, very excited to inform you that at this moment, we have more than 1,000 participants from 74 countries across 6 continents around the world. Wow, amazing. And they're streaming from both Zoom and YouTube. And yeah, we are very excited. We hope you are also very excited. And like I mentioned earlier, our speaker for today is Professor Takayuki Akahoshi. He is a chief executive surgeon at the Akihabara Cataract Clinic, and he is also a surgical director at the Nihonbashi Cataract Clinic, Tokyo, Japan. And at this moment, he will be presenting a very interesting topic to all of us with the title, Quality and Efficiency in Cataract Surgery. So the moderator for this webinar, as always, is Dr. Gede Pardianto. And he will be accompanied by Dr. Andrea Silitonga as the co-moderator. And both of them are from the Semek Eye Hospital, Medan, North Sumatra, Indonesia. So before we begin, this seminar will be divided into 2 sessions. The first one will be an online course with the title that I mentioned previously. And then the second session will be a discussion and also a Q&A with the speaker. So throughout this whole event, feel free to drop your questions to the Q&A box, not the chat box, the Q&A box, so that we can look through them and then we can answer them in the second session. So our distinguished participants, before we begin this webinar, let's first pay attention to the Indonesian national anthem. Thank you. All right, thank you. And then now we will pay attention to the Japanese national anthem. All right, thank you very much. And now we will begin the first session of this webinar. So, Dr. Gede Pardianto, the time is all yours.
Thank you so much, Vira, astrophysical from UC Berkeley. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Hello, hello, good morning Indonesia, good morning Japan, good morning Taka, konnichiwa.
Konnichiwa.
Thank you, Taka. And good day for our friends from all the rest of the world. It must be afternoon in Pacific, Australia, and New Zealand now, morning in Asia, early morning now in Europe and Africa, evening now in North America, Central America, and South America. First and foremost, thank you for joining. Welcome to this international webinar that is attended by near 1,000 very determined participant from 74 countries of 6 continents around the globe. Welcome our amazing delegates. Those are one of the best delegates in the world. We are gathering here all nations of the world to unite and to double our effort of humanity for helping the people against blindness. We welcome you with the spirit of cherry blossom sakura, those now are starting to bloom in Tokyo. Happy equinox to today. Welcome to our program, 1 hour with the maestro for amazing aid. I am Gede Pardianto from Indonesia, and this is Dr. Andrea Silitonga. We call her Dea. She is a young surgeon in Smek Eye Hospital, Medan, North Sumatra, Indonesia. Presenter twice at Asia Pacific Academy of Ophthalmology in Taiwan and in China. Ladies and gentlemen, the maestro this time will be Dr. Takayuki Akahoshi, a legend, my old friend, a great surgeon, an inventor, a champion, the man, the master, professor, sensei. Now, Dr. Akahoshi-san is chief executive surgeon at Akihabara Cataract Clinic. And also Akahoshi Sensei is surgical director at Nihonbashi Cataract Clinic. He is a professor at a professor of ophthalmology at Tokyo Women's Medical University and Gifu University, Harbin Medical University, Medical College of Fudan University, Kyoritsu Women's College, and University of Illinois, USA, and University Kebangsaan Malaysia. He is awarded with double Kelman Award. Wow! 2018 in Brazil and previously in 2017 in Greece on celebration of the 50 years anniversary of phaco surgery. The award is given to him as distinguished ophthalmologist in appreciation of his great contribution to ophthalmic surgery, not only as a surgeon, a pioneer and innovator, but also a great tutor. Once again, Taka is internationally renowned as inventor of phaco pre-chop technique and its related instrument. He is the fastest and largest volume surgeon who operates through the smallest incision in the world. No doubt, no question about it. He is a great teacher that has so far traveled to 68 countries for live surgery and lecture. And now, at this very moment, he is going to share his splendid idea with 1,000 people from 74 countries around the world. Wow, that was astonishing, breathtaking. At this moment, he will present a very interesting topic with the title Quality and Efficiency in Cataract Surgery. It will be a really fascinating topic. Now, we are learning from the man who is inventor and expert in this field. So be prepared. Fellow ophthalmologists, let's pay attention to Dr. Takayuki Takahoshi. As we know, Taka is from Japan, and Japan and its JAXA is awesome in space program. So Taka, we are counting down for you. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, time is yours, lift off. Okay, Taka.
Yes.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we hear you. It has been full screen now.
Okay.
Okay.
Good. Good morning. I'd like to talk about what I have done and what I'm doing to perform high quality cataract surgery efficiently. This is a 30 years record of my number of cataract cases in Japan. I was working as a director of ophthalmology at the Mitsui Memorial Hospital in Tokyo. It's a charity hospital as a director for 26 years. When I moved to the Mitsui, the number of the cases was about 300 cases per year. Then I start to perform the phacoprichop. The phacoprichop was invented in 1992. Then the number of the surgery is incredibly increasing. In 2004, I start to operate through sub 2 millimeter incision, and then the more patient come, and the number of the surgery is growing and growing. And I start to implant the toric IOL since 2012 using electric toric markers. So the quality of the surgery is so good. So many patients came to the hospital. 3 years back, I left the Mitsui Memorial Hospital. And now I'm currently working in mainly two clinics, Akihabara Cataract Clinic and Nihonbashi Cataract Clinic. I'm operating about 8,000 to 9,000 cases in Japan per year. In 2020, I operated 8,263 cases. Nowadays, I operate more multifocal cases. More than 24% of the cases are multifocal and 76% are monofocal. Among them, the toric patient is almost half. So this is a normal monofocal non-toric patient, but 40%. So rest of them, 60% of my cases are toric or multiple organ cases. In last year, I operated 8,263 cases. All cases are operated using a phaco pre-chop technique through sub-2mm incisions. I never used a femtosecond laser surgery. I ruptured the posterior capsule in 13 cases, 0.16%. I think it's very, very low instance. For more than 25 years, I have never had endophthalmitis, zero, for 25 years. The multifocal lens was 24%, and the toric was almost half of them are toric lenses. This is a list of my surgery last week. I usually operate between 60 to 70 cases a day. I have three sessions. In the morning session, I will operate about 30 cases, and after lunch break, I will operate another 30 to 40 cases in separate, in three sessions. These are the name of the patient. Yellow means the bilateral surgery. More than 95% of my cases are simultaneous bilateral surgeries. As you see, only few cases, as you see white, those are the unilateral cases. Most of them are already operated the fellow eye. This indicates the intraocular lens. The blue one is Carl Zeiss Atriza trifocal multifocal lens. Atriza, Panoptics, Physiol Fine Vision. You'll see many cases of multifocal lenses now. And orange one, the monofocal toric lens. In Japan, we have Acrisoft toric T3 to T9. And everybody in Japan is covered by social insurance. And also the toric lens is covered by social insurance system. So the cost for the patient is the same if it is toric or non-toric. So if the patient has an indication of toric lens, I automatically implant the lens, toric lens for those patients. The white one is non-toric, monofocal. You will see those patients are not so many nowadays. This is a case more than 20 years ago. At that time, I used the legacy. I need to operate, manage so many cases a day. So I try to operate as fast as possible. But this is a case with a patient. This patient had respiratory issues. She couldn't lay down long time on the operating table. So I need to operate quickly. The basic procedure of the surgery is exactly the same as I'm doing now. So the temporal clear corner incision, at that time the incision size was a little bit bigger, 3.2. And pre-chop the nucleus, I used the legacy machine. Even with this old machine, the cataract could be quite efficiently removed using a pre-chop technique. Using a Monarch screw type injector, clear Acrisoft at the time was injected, and the residual cortex was removed together with viscoelastic material in the anterior chamber. This is actually real time surgery, 1 minute 26 seconds, sealing the incision. I finished the case in 1 minute and 29 seconds. But nowadays, I need to operate so many cases, but I never hurry. My first priority is the quality of the surgery. I always use a topical anesthesia. The incision size is sub-2mm clear corneal incision, no suture. And I try to use toric lens and multifocal lenses. And bilateral daily surgery is my routine. I'll show you a case of my recent surgery, routine case. I will use street lamp to make a reference mark here. And with the interpretive toric marker, I'll mark the final axis. I measured the incision size, 2 millimeter, 1.9, doesn't go in. 1.8 gauge goes in. So this incision size is 1.8. 0.5% preservative-free lidocaine is injected for the intracameral anesthesia. The chamber is filled with dispersive viscoelastic material, viscoat. With capsulorhexis forceps, I'll make a 5.5 millimeter capsulorhexis. This gauge is axis marker, and also I could make a capsulorhexis mark on the cornea. After hydro dissection with a special cannula, fill up the chamber. And nowadays I have a lot of soft cases. So this is the new phaco pre-chopper, disc blade pre-chopper. It is a round blade, no sharp edge. Even the soft cataract, once the nucleus is divided into smaller pieces, following phacomalacication can be performed quite easily and much, much safely. Rotating the nucleus, we chop the nucleus into 6 pieces. All this dividing procedure is performed under the viscoelastic material. And this is an harmonic square phaco tip. The tip is bent towards its bevel, and I'll use in a bath mode. Mainly I'll use aspiration to remove the cataract. When the tip is occluded, I'll use a small amount of ultrasound energy just for the purpose of clearing the tip. Thus, the amount of the ultrasound energy required for the cataract removal is minimal, so there is no thermal damage. You will see the CDE, very small amount of CDE and short time, I can remove the cataract. This is a new IA tip, ball IA tip. The tip is ergonomically curved, so even the subincisional cortex can be quite easily removed. I used to vacuum the posterior capsule, but nowadays I don't do that because I don't want to stress the serial zoning. This is a case with trifocal lens, panoptics. For all the multifocal cases, I routinely implant capsular tension ring for the stable stable position of the intraocular lens. Using a Royale injector and D cartridge, now the panoptics 6 millimeter optic Aquisop lens was implanted through 1.8 millimeter incision. I will carefully remove the probisc, and this is a posterior capsule polisher. You will see fine cortical fibers attached on the posterior capsule. Using this polisher, I will gently polish the posterior capsule and wash out the cortical debris. Thus, I can reduce the stress on the ciliary zonules. There is no reciprocal movement of the phaco tip, and there's no thermal damage. Just increasing the intraocular pressure, the incision can be self-sealed quite easily. This is my routine case nowadays. Now, my policy of surgery is to provide the best treatment for every patient. So I'd like to talk how to increase the quality and efficiency in cataract surgery. And I'd like to introduce some items benefit for this purpose. When I was working at the Mitsui Memorial Hospital, which is a general hospital, I had 2 operating theaters, 2 microscopes, 2 centurions, 2 operating tables, and a set of the staffs preparing the patient. So what I did was quickly move between 2 rooms and manage 40, 50 cases a day without any issues. Now I'm working in the clinic. It has 1 big operating theater I have only one microscope, Lumera 700 and the Centurion. What is important in this operating theater is I have two tables, not the tables. Actually, it is an operating chair. It is very important for the comfort of the patient and also for the best operating position. When the patient come, patient sit here, and automatically it comes to the table like this. There's enough space under the table. I always sit temporal side of the patient. There's a foot pedal. Sometimes if you operate through the using a conventional surgical table, you will have the difficulty to manipulate the foot pedals. But in this operating theater, I have enough space to approach from temporally. I'm so comfortable using this table. Now, another important point is that the head position can be quite easily adjusted. Also for the table height is easily adjusted. So I can get very good red reflex from the fundus. So this is one of the important setting in the operating theater. I have one Centurion, one microscope, two tables. I have three scrub nurses and one circulating nurse. I'll see how the our staffs are moving in the operating theater. The efficiency is important, but the surgery should be performed perfectly. The patient come into the operating theater, sit down, and recline. It will become a table. My scrub nurse will clean the eyes. She will clean both eyes. It's me. Come. This is a table of the surgical schedule of the day. At a glance, I can get all the information of the patient. Both eyes are cleaned. Then the nurses will drape the patient. I'll sit on the temporal side of the patient, start the surgery, and finish. Then the nurses will prepare the fellow eye. I will change my glove and sit at the side of the patient. While the next patient is coming in the room, while I'm operating, the next patient is prepared. Both eyes are cleaned. I implant the lens. I finish this case. Both eyes of the patient are finished. I will never patch the eye. He will leave. And the next patient will move from this table to the table. Put the drape. And I can immediately start surgery. In this way, I can manage 60, 70 cases a day without any issues. I'd like to talk about the drape. Drape is a very important item to prevent endophthalmitis. You'll see how I put the drape on the patient. It has a slit on the drape, so it is not necessary to cut the drape after putting on the patient's face. Upper and lower lid is simultaneously covered by this plastic sheet. So meibomian secretion, which has a bacterial infection, contamination, can be completely blocked. This is a special speculum I designed for the temporal approach. In this way, upper and lower lid is completely covered by the drape. It is very important to prevent the endophthalmitis. Now, I designed a special drape, bilateral drape. It has a drape body and separate seat to put on the patient eye. two holes here and two pouches. And the slit is already pre-cut in the adhesive tape. After cleaning both eyes, the drape can be quite easily placed on the patient's face. It has a special folding. Just put on the face. The patient can open both eyes like this, and two pouches are here. And then I use a small plastic sheet to cover the upper and lower lid. I put in the speculum, and I will operate this first eye. While operating, the fellow eye is open, so the patient fixation, patient eye fixation is not good. I can lead the patient eye to good position using this eye. And some patients are afraid to cover the face during the surgery, claustrophobia, or it is good for the claustrophobia patient because both eyes are open during the surgery. So after finishing this eye, I just take out this pouch filled with an BSS, and then I will operate the fellow eye. Just put the plastic sheet and speculum. And after finishing both eyes, I remove whole drape. In this way, bilateral surgery can be quite efficiently performed. Put this bilateral drape, plastic sheet, speculum. I operate this eye, and when I finish the first eye, just remove the plastic sheet and the pouch. Then, for the second eye, I will put the plastic sheet, and when I finish all the surgery, all drape will be removed. In this way, draping of the patient can be performed quite easily and most efficiently. Speculum is another important item for the safe surgery. I have several types of the speculum according to the patient ID or the shape. I will choose the most appropriate speculum for the patient. Important point is that upper and lower lid is simultaneously covered to prevent the meibomian secretion. If the draping or the speculum was not proper, you will see the meibomian secretion will contaminate the surgical field. If you wash out this oil with a syringe, it will not be successful. You will see a lot of oil coming on the cornea. So I have a small plastic cup filled with the BSS. So the in such a the contamination, I just wash out during the surgery, during the PECO. It is most efficient way of clearing the surgical field. So this is a small item, but very important to keep the clean surgical field. I always use a diamond blade because the incision made by diamond blade is very clean and sharp and quite easy to self-seal. So the this is my main incision blade, auto diamond. This is a trapezoid design. At the shoulder, it's 2, at the base, 2.3. Nano diamond has 1.7 to 2. According to the depth of the incision, I can control the incision size. According to the lens power, if the lens is high power, I make a deep insertion to make a little bit larger incision so that I may not stress the incision. This is a side port knife, 0.6. As I implant a 6mm optic lens through sub 2mm incision, I will provide a counter force during the implantation. If the side port incision is too large, there will be a leakage of OVD during the incision. So if the intraocular pressure is not high enough during implantation, you will fail to inject the lens. So I prefer to use a small diamond sideboard knife for sideboard incision. Capsulorhexis is another important point. Well, the ideal capsulorhexis can result good post-operative refraction and less PCO. The ideal size of the capsulorhexis, I believe, is 5.5. At the end of the surgery, the capsulorhexis edge should be uniformly on the optic, like this. If the capsulorhexis was larger asymmetrically, the lens will tilt it, and it will cause the lens-induced astigmatism. Or the capsulorhexis is too large, the lens will come anteriorly, it will change the myotic shift or the refraction. So especially for the toric lens or multifocal lens, the size and position of the capsulorhexis is a very important point. With the former rhexis marker, which requires ink, something like this, it will hinder the visibility of the capsule and during the phaco. So I didn't like to use this type of the markers. So, I designed a special capsulorhexis marker. The blade edge is very thin, 0.1 millimeter, and I made a special modification at that edge. It's a very unique CCC marker. And for the capsulorhexis, I will use Uterata capsulorhexis forceps, but I redesigned it in a very thin and very sharp through 1.8 or 1.7 millimeter, very, very small incision. I can manipulate the capsulorhexis quite easily. This is an capsule forceps with CCC guide. You can mark the capsulorhexis size with this marker, and also you can perform the ideal capsulorhexis using this forceps. This is magic mark. You can clearly see the mark on the cornea when it is dry. But once the cornea is wet, the mark will disappear. You will clearly see the mark. When I wet the cornea, it disappears. So it will never hinder the visibility of the anterior chamber during the surgical procedures, such as the phaco or IA. Mark the cornea, you will clearly see the mark. With the forceps, just follow this mark. Make ideal size of capsulorhexis. At the end of the surgery, the capsulorhexis is uniformly cover the optical edge of the lens. In this manner of the fixation, post-refractive result is perfect, and also the PCO ratio is quite low. So I briefly explain how I make the capsulorhexis. For the fixation of the patient, I have asked the patient to look at the center of the lights. When the cornea is dry, I just make, press the marker and make a mark on the cornea and inject viscose. I used to use a soft shell technique using viscose and Provis, but nowadays I use just the viscose. Fill up the chamber and the viscose and keep positive pressure in the anterior chamber. My capsulorhexis is three steps. It is important to hold the forceps horizontally so that there is less leakage of OVD through the incision. Using the right side of the blade, puncture the anterior capsule, cut the radius, grasp it, and discretionary direction you can make the bring the edge to the marker, and continue centripetal, orthogonal, and then re-grasp, and the second step, repeat the same procedure three times, and capsulorhexis is completed. Mark the cornea while cornea is dry, not wet. Make incision, fill up the chamber with viscose. With special uterine forceps, puncture the capsule, grasp it, first stage, second stage, re-grasp, and third stage, complete the laxis. If the patient fixation is not good, this patient has a nystagmus, I'll use a nucleus sustainer to fix the eyeball. Using a nucleus sustainer, this instrument is used for the counter-bridge of technique. Fixing the eye position, I can easily make a capsular laxis like this. Hydrodissection is, I believe, one of the most important steps in cataract surgery. I designed a special 27-gauge cannula for hydrodissection, and small trick, but it is very important trick, is this cannula should be attached to a small syringe. You should not use a big syringe. 5 or 10 cc syringe is not acceptable. I always use 2 or 2.5 small syringe. This is a hydrodissection cannula with a very special cannula. The wall thickness is very thin, so lumen is larger, even this 27 gauge cannula. So small amount of BSS can be quite quickly injected using this cannula. The cannula tip is tapered, so at the end of the surgery, the incision can be sealed quite easily using this cannula. I'll show you how to perform the hydrodissection. After making the complete capsular laxis, fill up the chamber with viscose. Then I will introduce the cannula horizontally and introduce the cannula tip under the anterior capsule. Then lift the anterior capsule a little bit, rotate the cannula 90 degrees, and then small amount of BSS is quickly injected. For this purpose, I do recommend to use a small syringe, not a big one. And then when you inject the BSS, the nucleus will come up. Then you should push the nucleus downwards so that the BSS between the nucleus and capsule may spread uniformly in the capsular bag. Then ascertain that the nucleus can rotate freely in the capsular bag. Free rotation of the lens is mandatory. You should check the nucleus can rotate freely in the capsular bag before you proceed to the next step. Introduce the cannula horizontally, push the nucleus downwards, and ascertain that the free rotation. That's it. Quite easy. Push the nucleus downward, rotate. This simple hydrodissection is very, very important for the following procedure of the cataract surgery. To improve the efficiency, there are 2 points. First, reduce the operating time. Second, reduce the non-operating time. First, I'd like to talk about how to reduce the operating time, the surgical technique and new technology. The phaco pre-chop is a key of my success in quality and number, quantity of my surgery. The phaco pre-chop is a mechanical nuclear fracture performed prior to the phaco emulsification. I started pre-chop the nucleus in 1992 in Japan, and I got the Film Festival Award, ASCUS Film Festival Award in 1994. Before that, I performed the divide and conquer technique. It is a very, very good technique, but grooving the nucleus takes time, and this movement sometimes damage the incision. there are so much loss of the outer sun energy because the tip is not completely occluded. There are so much loss of the outer sun energy. But in the Fako pre-chop, nucleus is divided, chopped prior to the Fako under the viscoelastic material. So there's no energy required to dividing the nucleus. Once the nucleus is divided, following Fako mummification is quite easy and rapid because all the outer sun energy can be effectively used to emulsify the nucleus. Nowadays, femtosecond laser can pre-chop the nucleus, but there's a limitation of the laser pre-chop. The posterior plate of the nucleus always remains using a femtosecond laser. So Fako surgeon, Philip Krasman from France, Dr. Longyo, my friend in Singapore, developed their own pre-chopper to break the posterior plate of the nucleus. But I think I can pre-chop the nucleus using the femtosecond. Femtosecond laser has a limitation of the cases. Small pupil, deep-set eye, advanced glaucoma, corneal opacity, white dense cataract. It is difficult to use a femtosecond laser to pre-chop the nucleus, but I can manage all these cases using my manual Fako pre-chop technique. I operate more than 10,000 cases. All my cases are operated using pre-chop technique. There's no limitation of the application. No NH required. I can attain complete nuclear division. And if you have just an instrument, pre-chopper, you can manage many, many cases. We don't need to buy such an expensive femtosecond laser. Before you perform the Fako pre-chop, there are three important preparation prerequisites. First, protect the corneal endothelium using a dispersive type of viscoelastic material such as viscoat. Make a complete capsulorhexis and sufficient hydrodissection. There are three important prerequisites before you perform the Fako pre-chop. The procedure of pre-chop will never damage the corneal endothelium, but once the nucleus was divided into smaller pieces, during the Fako pre-chop, nuclear fragment, during the Fako emulsification, nuclear fragment may come into the anterior chamber and it may hit the corneal endothelium. So to protect the corneal endothelium, I always use dispersive viscoat to fill up the chamber first. Then make a capsulorhexis without tears or notches. I prefer to make 5.5 mm capsulorhexis. Then very, very important point is hydrodissection. This is my special hydrodissection cannula. Attach it to a small syringe, 2.5cc syringe. Introduce the cannula horizontally and perform the cortical cleaving hydrodissection if possible. Then when you perform the hydrodissection, viscoat may come out through the incision, so I will fill up the chamber again with viscoat. And at the same time, I will clear the anterior surface of the nucleus for better visibility of the nucleus. Fill up the chamber with viscoat. Fill up the chamber. Keep positive pressure with special uterator forceps. Make 5.5 meter complete capsulorhexis without tears or notches. Hydrodissection using a special cannula. Push the nucleus downwards. Be certain that the nucleus can rotate freely in the capsular bag. Fill up the chamber again with viscoat to clear the cortical anterior cortex. In the Fako pre-chop, there are only two methods: karate pre-chop technique and counter pre-chop technique. You can choose according to the necessity of nuclear support. If it is not necessary to support the nucleus, you can choose karate technique. If it is necessary to support a nucleus, you should use counter-pressure technique. For the karate, the stress on the ciliary zone is equalized and minimized. In soft cataract, you can perform karate technique, pushing the nucleus downwards. Continue to push the nucleus downwards. Nucleus can be breached out. But in case with a dense cataract, you need to support the nucleus with a second instrument to reduce the stress on the ciliary zonules and the capsular back. By providing the counter force, you can safely breach up even the dense cataract. So I'd like to explain about the karate technique first. The indication of the karate technique is soft nucleus with complete capsular axis and intact ciliary zonules. For this technique, I'll use a combo type combo pre-chopper. Combo pre-chopper has a combination of sharp angular blade and blunt round blade. This sharp side of the blade is suitable to insert into the nucleus, and this round blunt side is suitable to attain complete separation of the nucleus. The position of the pre-chopper insertion is just the center of the nucleus. The angular side of the blade is placed at the center of the nucleus. Pushing the nucleus downwards, bury the whole blade into the nucleus. At the blade height, blade thickness is just, this thickness is just 1.5, less than 2, and the nuclear thickness, cataract thickness is more than 4. So even though the whole blade is buried in the nucleus, it is safe. If you insert too superficially, you cannot separate the nucleus. Insert whole blade into the nucleus and then continue to push the nucleus downwards. Continue to keep pushing the nucleus downwards and then open the blade slowly. Not quickly, slowly. When the complete division has been attained, you can observe the inner surface of the posterior capsule between two pre-chopper nuclear fragments. Place the pre-chopper to the distal end of the nucleus, open, then place the pre-chopper to the proximal part of the nucleus, open. From surface to the bottom, from proximal to distal end, make a complete division of the nucleus. When you rotate the nucleus, restore each bisected nuclear fragment into its original position, and using the angular side of the blade, rotate the nucleus 90 degrees. And then angular side of the blade is inserted into the nucleus, open it, and then distal half of the nucleus is opened like this. Then flip the blade upside down and the rounded side of the blade can be safely used to a certain complete division. In this way, without using any outer sound energy, nucleus can be divided into four pieces quite easily. You can take enough time because you can fill up the chamber with this coat and within a good visibility, you can take time to attain complete division using this karate pre-chopper technique. The angular side of the blade is placed at the center of the nucleus. Direction of insertion is just downwards. Pushing the nucleus downwards, open the blade slowly. Distal end, proximal end should be completely separated. Restore its original position. Rotate the nucleus 90 degrees and repeat the same procedure. The direction of insertion is just downward. Rounded side of the blade can be safely used to ascertain complete division. You will see how the nucleus is divided in the capsular back, like this. I'll show you again. The position of insertion is just center of the nucleus, direction of insertion is just downwards. Pushing the nucleus downwards, open the blade slowly, not quickly. Proximal distal end of the nucleus should be completely separated. Restore its original position, rotate 90 degrees. If the hydrodissection has been performed perfectly, the nuclear rotation is not difficult. But if the hydrodissection was not perfect, you will have a difficulty to rotate the nucleus. Rounded side of the blade can be safely used to complete the vision. Normal speed. The position of insertion is just the center, rotate 90 degrees. Repeat the same procedure to pre-chop the nucleus into four pieces. That's it. Quite easy and quick. If you want to pre-chop the nucleus further into smaller pieces, if the patient has a small number of the corneal endothelium or some risky patient, if you pre-chop the nucleus further into six pieces, the following phaco mastication should be much easier. But there are some contraindication of karate technique. Those are the hard nucleus. If you try to insert a pre-chopper into the nucleus, and if you have any difficulty to insert a new pre-chopper, it is obviously not the case for the karate technique. In case with incomplete capsulorhexis, if there is a tear in the capsulorhexis, you should not perform karate technique. Cases with subluxated lens, shoulder exfoliation syndrome, those weak zonules, you should not perform karate technique. There are only two methods in the phaco pre-chop. Contraindication of karate technique is an indication of counter pre-chop technique. The indication of counter pre-chop technique is in a hard nucleus, incomplete capsulorhexis, weak zonules. In those cases, we need to support the nucleus with a second instrument. For this technique, I will use a nucleus sustainer. It looks like a chopper, but there is a microball attached at the tip of the instrument. So I can support the nucleus at the deep portion safely. This is a pre-chopper, universal pre-chopper, much sharp pre-chopper for a dense cataract. For the nucleus sustainer, I have two versions. Normal sustainer, I use this for counter pre-chop technique, also during the phaco, also for the implanting the lens. But in case with the myopic patient, has a very deep anterior chamber and a big nucleus, it is important to support the nucleus at the deep equatorial portion. I cannot reach with this conventional sustainer. So for this myopic patient, I will use a long tip sustainer for those cases. After making the complete capsulorhexis, I will carefully introduce the nucleus sustainer at the equatorial portion of the nucleus, and then sharp universal pre-chopper is used. The important point is that the tip of the sustainer and tip of the pre-chopper and central hardest core of the nucleus should be aligned on the same line or same axis. If we support the nucleus too superficially, you cannot provide a proper counterforce to the pre-chopper. It is important to support the nucleus at the deep part of the nucleus. As there is a microball at the tip, you can safely support the nucleus. For myopic patient, I use a special nucleus sustainer to support the nucleus at the deep point. Tip of the sustainer, tip of the pre-chopper, and the hardest part of the nucleus should be always aligned in the same line. Bring two instruments closer. Sometimes nucleus sustainer can be used like a chopper to cut the nucleus, and providing the counterforce, you can open the blade without stressing the ciliary zonules. Divide the nucleus from surface to bottom, from proximal to the distal end, like this. Using two instruments, rotate the nucleus 90 degrees. Carefully introduce the nucleus sustainer to the deep equatorial portion. In case with a dense cataract or 5 mature cataract, I always stain the capsule
so that the nucleus sustainer can introduce the proper port. If you support the nucleus over the capsule, you will have a focal tear of the anterior capsule or focal zonule ruptures. So you should carefully introduce the sustainer under the capsule lexis edge. Divide the nucleus into four pieces. You can repeat the same procedure to pre-chop the nucleus further into six or eight pieces as much as you like. Important point is the tip of the sustainer, tip of the pre-chopper, and the hardest core of the nucleus should be aligned on the same line or same axis. Carefully introduce the nucleus sustainer under the capsule lexis edge. Open the blade several times to ascertain complete division. Now the nucleus is divided into four pieces. Each quadrant can be pre-chopped in the same way as much as you like. Once the nucleus is pre-chopped, I'll use phaco tip bevel down so that the old outer sound energy can be effectively used to emulsify the nucleus. I'll use a burst mode to reduce the total outer sound energy. Once the nucleus is pre-chopped into small pieces, even the dense cataract can be removed like this in a short time. Important point is that the tip of the sustainer, tip of the pre-chopper, and the hardest part of the nucleus should be aligned on the same axis. Open the blade several times to ascertain complete division. Merely making a crack into the nucleus is not enough. Important point is make a complete division from surface to the bottom of the nucleus. Sometimes the posterior plate of the nucleus may remain, but the important point is to separate that part. This is a case of the Schuld exfoliation syndrome. The lens was subluxated, four retractors were used to open the pupil, and another four retractors are placed at the capsule lexis edge to support, sustain the lens. Even in such a subluxated lens, if you provide an proper counterforce, you can safely pre-chop such a dense cataract. To summarize the phaco pre-chop, there are two methods, karate and counter. If it is not necessary to support a nucleus, such as a soft cataract with intact zonule complete capsule lexis, using a combo pre-chopper, you can perform karate technique. In case with a dense cataract, those cases, weak zonules or incomplete capsule lexis, you need to support the nucleus. In those cases, you will use universal pre-chopper and nucleus sustainer and perform counter pre-chop technique. So if you have two pre-choppers, combo and universal and nucleus sustainer, you can manage all the kind of the cataract. This is a basic instrument set. Good speculum, capsule lexis marker, capsule lexis forceps, two pre-choppers, sustainer, and hydrodissection cannula. This is my key instrument to manage any kind of the cataract. When I travel abroad for surgery, I always carry at least this basic instrument. Important point is to break the posterior plate of the nucleus completely from surface to the bottom, from proximal to the distal end of the nucleus. Nucleus should be completely separated. Merely making the crack into the nucleus is not enough. Important point is to separate the posterior plate of the nucleus. But once you try the pre-chop, you will see some difficulties in the procedures. For soft cataract, you can use a combo pre-chopper. For a dense cataract, you can use a universal pre-chopper. But in some cases, too dense for the karate technique, but too soft for counter pre-chop technique. Those cases are very difficult to perform the phaco pre-chop. So I modified the current combo type pre-chopper. This is a current pre-chopper, combo pre-chopper. It has a sharp blade on this side, and this side of the blade is round and blunt. So I modified to this new model. This part of the blade is sharp. This is a new combo pre-chopper, double edge. This part is sharp, this part is sharp, and only this part is blunt. So also the blade thickness was modified very, very thin, like this. So this is a medium nucleus. It was difficult to perform the karate technique with a conventional pre-chopper, but at the tip it's sharp and blade thickness is very thin. Such a medium nucleus can be managed by the karate technique with this new combo pre-chopper. This is an obviously dense cataract. I need to use a counter pre-chopper technique. But with a universal pre-chopper, sometimes such a medium nucleus was difficult to pre-chop. But with this new combo pre-chopper, I can safely perform a counter pre-chopper technique like this. So this new pre-chopper was named Combo 4 pre-chopper. You can manage soft cataract by karate technique, and using a counter pre-chopper technique, you can also manage moderate nucleus. In 2018, the ESCRS meeting was in Vienna. I was walking in the street of a beautiful city, and I noticed an interesting window here. Inspired from the window, I designed a Vienna window pre-chopper. It is also the new generation pre-chopper with a two sharp edge here. And compared with a conventional combo 4, it has the bigger angle, so suitable for the karate technique. And combo 4 is suitable for counter pre-chopper technique. So after hydro dissection, even a very soft cataract or the medium cataract, this Vienna window pre-chopper can work quite properly. The blade height is high, so it can separate the nucleus efficiently, and the sharp edge is suitable to insert to medium nucleus. Rounded side of the nucleus can be safely used to attain the complete separation. Once the nucleus is pre-chopped, each pre-chopped nuclear fragment can be easily recognized. So this is a new generation pre-chopper. Nowadays in Tokyo, many patients come earlier for cataract surgery, and some patients want to correct the presbyopia by a multifocal lens. I have more chance to operate such a soft cataract. PECO pre-chopper is quite safe procedure. I have never ruptured the capsule by PECO pre-chopper procedure by itself. But psychologically, most of the doctors may be afraid to insert a sharp pre-chopper into the soft nucleus. So I designed another pre-chopper. This pre-chopper has a disc blade like this. There's no sharp edge at all. It is suitable for soft cataract or for those who use a femsecond. There are two types. This is the full sharp edge design, and another design is another half of the circle is blunt, and the positioning hole is eccentric, so you can see which side of the blade is sharp and which side of the blade is blunt. You will see this is a full edge model, round disc pre-chopper. As the blade is very thin, can be easily inserted into the nucleus. Using a nucleus sustainer, you can rotate a nucleus. A soft cataract can be safely and quite easily pre-chopped like this. This is a small pupil. This is a half edge model. Sharper side of the blade is used to insert into the nucleus. Pre-chop the nucleus into four pieces. This may be a diabetic patient. The pupil dilatation is not good. But once the nucleus is pre-chopped, each pre-chopped nuclear fragment can be safely emulsified even through a small pupil. I just used a Phaco tip bevel down, and pre-chopped nuclear fragment can automatically come to the Phaco tip. So this is a disc blade pre-chopper suitable for the soft cataract. So with a disc blade pre-chopper and the new combo pre-chopper and universal pre-choppers, I can manage any kind of the nucleus. So there are so many types of the pre-choppers. Many doctors may wonder which one should they buy. I don't have the patent on the pre-choppers. So there are many companies produce the pre-choppers in the world. Some pre-choppers are made of titanium, but I don't recommend to use a titanium pre-chopper because the titanium is too soft and too bulky, and it is not sharp enough for the pre-chopping the nucleus. I do recommend to use a stainless steel pre-chopper, and there are many good pre-choppers produced by ASICO. I recommend to use the ASICO pre-chopper. Those are the catalog numbers of the ASICO. If you have never tried the pre-chopper, I do recommend to start from the soft cataract. You should not try from the dense cataract. First, you should start from the soft cataract. So if you are the beginner of the Phaco pre-chop, and if you want to buy only one, I recommend the Vienna window pre-chopper or the disc blade pre-chopper for those soft cataract using for the karate pre-chop technique. If you also want to try a little bit medium nucleus, I recommend combo 4 pre-chopper with a nucleus sustainer. You can use the karate technique for the soft cataract, and for the dense cataract, you can use a combo 4 pre-chopper for the counter pre-chop technique. If you want to manage any kind of the nucleus from soft to dense, you will need a sharp universal pre-chopper for the dense nucleus for the counter pre-chop technique, and the Vienna window may be a choice. If you operate only soft cataract for the refractive surgery or the flux, I do recommend to use a disc blade pre-chopper. Or if you operate only a dense cataract, universal pre-chopper with a nucleus sustainer should be a choice. But if you first try to do the pre-chop, I do recommend to start from the soft cataract, and you see how the nucleus will pre-chopped. And then if you have the confidence, gradually you move to the dense cataract. And if you are a rich surgeon, you can now buy all these instruments, and you can enjoy Phaco pre-chop using different types of the pre-choppers. Now, I will talk about how to manage, how to Phaco modify the pre-chop nucleus. I will use a harmonic tip, Akahoshi bent tip. It's a bevel down technique, and I use in a burst mode. I will shortly explain about the harmonic tip. I use an Alcon Centurion with a torsional Phaco. If I use the round tip, the side of the tip works for the cutting the nucleus. But if it is round, the cutting efficiency is not good. If the tip shape is square, the cutting efficiency should be enhanced. And also, the tip shaft was off-centered. Most of the tip has a coaxial shaft, but the harmonic tip has an off-centered shaft. So using a torsional handpiece, it will create the wobbling motion. So the Phaco efficiency is much enhanced with this harmonic tip. This is a round flare tip from Alcon. This is a harmonic tip. this is a very dense cataract. I need to use a counter Prechov technique to Prechov the nucleus. This is a harmonic strip with its bevel down. I use vast mode, and Prechov nucleus can be quite easily and rapidly removed. You will see the CDE only 2.29 with a very, very small amount of the NH and a small amount of BSS consumption. The nucleus can be removed. Among the 300 grade 3 nucleus, compared with the conventional round layer tip, the CDE is almost half in harmonic tip. Aspiration time is almost half. And also, the BSS consumption is much less than the conventional layer tip. This, you will see, I aspirate the posterior capsule, the vacuum is over 500. Again, I aspirate the posterior capsule by accident, vacuum is nearly 400. The posterior capsule doesn't rupture. Why? This is a scanning electron microscope view of the conventional phaco tip. The tip edge is sharp and rough like this, but the harmonic tip is smooth and round. As the edge is so smooth, as long as you don't emit the outer sound NH, the posterior capsule is safe, even though you aspirate the capsule by accident. This is one of the reasons my posterior capsule rupture rate is very, very low. Among the 8,000 cases, I ruptured the capsule only 13 cases last year. For the phaco tip, there are three types of their bending: straight tip, Kelman bent, and reverse Kelman Akabashi bent. My tip is bent toward its bevel. If you perform divide and conquer technique, you may use straight tip or Kelman tip. If you perform phaco chop technique, you can use Kelman tip or straight tip. But if you want to use phaco prick chop technique, I do recommend to use Akahoshi style reverse Kelman bending phaco tip. Because if the tip is bent toward its bevel, I can quite easily make a complete occlusion of the phaco tip toward the nucleus, and all the outer sound energy can be effectively used to emulsify the nucleus. And also the tip shaft is almost parallel to the incision, so there is no mechanical or thermal damage of the incision by the during the phaco emulsification. If you try the Kelman tip after pre-chopping the nucleus, the tip will not occlude perfectly. You will have the difficulty to occlude the tip, and also there is so much stress on the incisions. If you use bevel down, irrigation will hit the corneal endothelium, and it will damage the corneal endothelium. So definitely, I do recommend to Akahoshi style the reverse Kelman tip after pre-chopping the nucleus. I will bring the nucleus toward the phaco tip. The tip is always used bevel down. Make a complete occlusion, and at the position 1 or position 2, and hear the sound of the vacuum. The phaco machine creates the sound to notice the vacuum. With the higher sound, if you hear, the occlusion is perfect. And mainly use an aspiration to remove the cataract. When the tip is occluded, and you will hear the alarm kinking sound, you will use a small amount of the ultrasound energy just for the purpose of clearing tip. Ultrasound energy is used just for the purpose of the clearing the tip. You should mainly use a vacuum aspiration to remove the cataract. Then the small nuclear filament remained at the end of the phaco. I will always use a nucleus sustainer pushing the posterior capsule away from the tip. In this way, the tip and the capsule has some distance. You can prevent the rupture of the posterior capsule. It is a very small trick, but a very important technique to prevent the posterior capsule rupture. For this manipulation, I use a nucleus manipulator, which I use for the counter pre-chop technique. And also another important tip for the phacomalsification is after pre-chopping the nucleus, we should approach from the periphery of the nucleus. You should not approach from the hardest part of the nucleus. I pre-chopped the nucleus into four pieces and I made a study. First, in this case, two quadrant was removed from the core of the nucleus, and another two quadrant was removed. Another half was removed from the periphery and compared to the CDE. Obviously, if you approach from the periphery of the nucleus, the CDE was much less. If you use a nucleus sustainer after pre-chopping the nucleus, you can flip the nucleus upside down, and if you approach from the periphery of the nucleus, you can reduce the energy. I will approach from the periphery of the nucleus. The tip was buried in the nucleus, and I use mainly vacuum. When the tip is occluded, I use phaco just for the purpose of clearing the tip. As the tip is bent towards its bevel, I can quite easily make a complete occlusion of the tip. When the tip is occluded, small amount of the outer sound energy is used just for the purpose of clearing the tip. You will see the CDE 1.22 and the amount of the irrigation is very small. I do recommend to use a burst mode with a Akabuchi style bending harmonics tip, bevel down, and making the complete occlusion using a high vacuum. And for the phaco, I'll use burst mode. If you use a linear mode, there are so much loss of the outer sound energy, and it will make damage on the incision or the corneal endothelium. In the burst mode, I always set the 100% power. The interval of the phaco emission is controlled by the foot pedal. For the soft nucleus, I set the on time of the burst short. But in case with the denser cataract, I set the on time longer. And only the interval of the phaco emission is controlled by the foot pedal. Many people say that I'm always using a very, very high parameters for the phaco modification, but it is not true. I have different 27 settings in my phaco machine, and according to the case, I always choose the best setting for each patient. I use the Centurion because I can get in a stable anterior chamber thanks to the active fluidics with a soft BSS back. I can adjust three parameters, US power, longitudinal and torsional, and I can adjust the IOP. Even at the low pressure of 20 millimeter mercury, I can safely operate the case thanks to the active fluidics system of Centurion. And also I'll adjust the aspiration flow rate. I will change these three parameters according to the cases. For the US power, if the patient has a soft nucleus, such as grade 1 or grade 2, which I can pre-chop the nucleus using a karate technique, I will use a soft setting. The medium nucleus or the dense cataract, grade 3, 4, 5, I need a counter pre-chop technique. Those cases, I use the medium and hard settings. For the soft cataract, I use the longitudinal on time 30 millisecond and torsional on time 300 millisecond. Medium and hard 40, 400, hard 50 and 500. According to the nuclear density, I will select these three different settings. If the patient had advanced glaucoma or the penetrating trauma or the weak zonules such as shield exfoliation or the posterior capsule rupture, I will reduce the pressure, intraocular pressure, but some myopic patients complain of pain during phaco modification. So in high myopic patient, I use the medium intraocular pressure. Otherwise, I use the high pressure. For low pressure, I set the pressure 20 millimeter mercury. Normally, I use 110, but my aspiration time may be less than 30 seconds, usually less than 30 seconds. So I don't care this high pressure. I've never had issues after using this pressure. For my patient, I may use 70 or 80 millimeter mercury. In case with Guttata low corneal endothelium count or the shallow anterior chamber, weak zonulotropy iris, or the posterior capsule ruptures, in those cases, I will reduce the aspiration flow rate. Otherwise, I use a high flow rate for the quick phaco modification. Usually, my flow rate is 45 to 50 cc per minute. But in certain challenging cases, I will reduce the flow rate down to 25. It will take a long aspiration time, long phaco time, but the corneal endothelium will be preserved. And also, I will inject frequently viscose. In this way, I have 27 different settings in the phaco machine. And according to the cases, I will choose the most appropriate cases for each case. This is the case with pseudo-exfoliation syndrome, subluxated lens. 8 retractors was used, 4 for open the pupil and another 4 to sustaining the lens. I set the pressure 20 millimeter mercury and flow rate 25. So even such a subluxated lens, I can safely remove the cataract at the low pressure, low flow, but the nucleus was denser, I use in the medium setting. This is a very dense cataract, but the cases has intact ciliary zonules and deep anterior chamber. This is a myopic patient. So the I set the high setting of the phaco machine. So in a short time, dense cataract can be safely and quickly removed. So according to the cases, I always change the setting of the phaco machine. Even such a dense cataract, if the fluidix is high, you can reduce the ultrasound NH and there's no thermal damage of the incision. Regarding to the astigmatism, I operate through a small incision. If the incision size is less than 2, there's no surgical induced astigmatism. According to the incision size, the incision, surgical induced astigmatism is higher. With a conventional surgery, if the incision size was large, even if the patient has no astigmatism, the surgery itself created the astigmatism. By inducing the incision size down to 2 millimeter, I will never induce the surgical astigmatism. But the issue is if the patient had a corneal astigmatism before surgery, I cannot correct this astigmatism even I operate through sub 2 millimeter incision. One idea is to implant a normal lens and touch up by LASIK. But my strategy is use a toric intraocular lens. My policy of the recent surgery is to correct the astigmatism by cataract surgery. So I use the sub 2 millimeter small incision and the toric IOL. Actually, last year, nearly 50% of my cases are toric. As I mentioned, in Japan, toric lens is regarded as normal lens. Everybody in Japan is covered by social insurance. So the cost for the patient is the same, even if it's non-toric or the toric. So if the patient has an indication of the toric lens, I automatically implant the toric lens for the good result. For the toric lens, alignment of the axis is very important because 1 degree of misalignment will cause 3% loss of the toric effect. there is 30 degrees of the misalignment. There's no effect of the toric lens, and if the lens rotate more, it will create another astigmatism. If I have a chance to see the patient before surgery, I will use a slit lamp to mark the axis. I used to use this gauge to make the final axis for the surgery. But nowadays, for the better accuracy, I just make reference mark, 3 and 9 o'clock position, and sometimes only one mark on the 3 o'clock position. And then intraoperatively, I use intraoperative axis gauge. And the final axis is marked on the cornea as well as the capsulorhexis mark at the same time. If I don't have a chance to see the patient preoperatively in the clinic, I will use electric toric marker. The conventional toric marker has an air bubble. It is not so accurate, and the surgeon cannot concentrate on the patient's eye and the air bubble at the same time. But this is a new electric toric marker. Light and sound tells us the horizontal position of the marker. If the marker is horizontal, green light is on and stop beeping. The accuracy of this device is 0.2 degrees. I prefer to use this electric reference marker. With this device, I mark 3 and 9 o'clock position, and intraoperatively, I use this intraoperative gauge. Compared with a conventional gauge, which is placed on the scleral, this new gauge marker is small, placed on the cornea. So even in a case with narrow lids, a small eye, we can safely mark the cornea. This is a dial. I've set the axis on this dial, and there are two spikes. Two spikes are set to the axis reference mark. There are two blades to mark the axis, and also it has the 5.5 capsulorhexis mark. So I can set two arrows to the reference mark, and axis is marked here, and at the same time, I can mark 5.5 capsulorhexis mark. While cornea is dry, I can make the capsulorhexis along this 5.5 millimeter mark. And then after removing the cataract, this is the axis of toric. There are three dots of the axis. Using a nucleus sustainer, I hold the lens, prevent rotation, and probisc is removed. And the axis is quite easily set to the final position. So there are some tricks with the intraoperative axis adjustment. I've used a nucleus sustainer to prevent the rotation when I remove the OPD. And first, I'll see the incision first, not set the axis, but first see the incision and increase the intraoperative pressure by VSS, then rotate the IOL to the desired axis. Most of the doctors, surgeons may think that the lens can rotate only the clockwise, but it's not true. The lens can rotate any directions. The long axis is caused by IOL rotation, but not marking. No surgical adjustment. IOL rotation happens mostly on the day of the surgery, after surgery. So I always advise the patient to avoid training stamps. Quick movement of the eye can rotate the nucleus. And also, in case with a myopic patient, I will implant CTR to prevent the lens rotation because my patient has a large capsular back and the lens, toric lens is quite easy to rotate. So for adjusting the lens first, seal the incision, important point, seal the incision first, and then you can rotate lens any directions. If you push the lens this way, in this case, this is in the final point of the axis, the lens is here. You will see how easily the lens can counter-rotate like this. So important point is first sealing the incision and injecting the BSS, opening the back, you can rotate the lens at any direction. Okay, so using the toric lens, now I can eliminate the issue of the astigmatism. And the final part of the surgery is how to reduce the non-operating time. Important point is the preparation. You worked in the Mitsui Memorial Hospital for 26 years. But after the JCI, the efficiency of the surgery was quickly dropped. But what is important is to reduce the non-operating time. For this purpose, perfect preparation, quick patient exchange, and teamwork. The patient is ready in the preparatory room. Each patient have the intravenous antibiotic drip infusion, and they have the manchet. And some patients have the cable for the electrocardiogram. When the patient come into the operating theater, the nurses will just connect the cable and tube. And when the surgery is finished, they quickly remove that one. This is a minimum instrument set. Everything is prepared in advance. I have 20 sets of minimum sets in a tray, and everything, viscoid, probisc, hydrodissection, everything is prepared in advance. I have the custom pack. In my custom pack, 7 sets of drape and syringes are prepared. So the nurse open one custom pack, 7 sets are quite easily prepared. So prepare everything. And also for the lens, I don't like the preloaded lens. I prefer to use a Royal injector with D cartridge. So my nurse will prepare the lens in advance using the magnifiers. So thus, in this way, I can operate 60 or 70 cases a day. But how can I operate 10,000 cases a year? This is my surgical schedule. I need to work 365 days a year. So sometimes I need lactation. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Taka.
Hi.
Lecture, exquisite presentation. That was very, very terrific. So, fellow ophthalmologists, now we are approaching the question and answer session. There are so many questions for from our participants. Those maybe are one of the most curious doctors on earth. May they help me to read its question to our maestro. Yeah, please. Yes.
Hello, Prof. Akohoshi.
Yes.
The first question is from Dr. Edianto from Indonesia. Mm-hmm. He said, hello, Professor. I would like to ask about how do you manage related of the possibility of infection from one operating room to the other?
I just use the one operating theaters, and for each eye, I change all the instrument. I operate both eyes at the same time. I change everything instrument for each eyes. And another important point is that I give the antibiotic moxifloxacin, Vegamox, 1 week before surgery. And also I will advise the patient to wash the face before come to the operating theaters, washing the face with the soap. And then there, I already shown how to clean the eyes before surgery. After I finishing the one eye, when I operated the second eye, I irrigate iodine solution before starting the second surgery.
Okay.
Thank you for your answer. For the second question, Dr. Elok from Indonesia would like to ask about, would you please give us some tips for being fit to perform tremendous number of surgery every day?
I already explained. What is important is to reduce the operating time using Phaco-Prechop technique and also the new technology, new Phaco machine. Centurion helps me a lot. And another important point is to reduce the non-operating time. In some operating theaters, it takes a long, long preparation time, but I prepare everything in advance. So quick patient exchange, quick instrument exchange, and quick staff exchange. I have three nurses helping me during the operating theater, during the surgery, and there is a good teamwork is an important key for the successful, safe, efficient surgery.
Okay. Thank you so much, Sensei. The next question from Angola. How do you prepare yourself to do high volume Phaco emulsification almost every day?
I go to bed early at night. I don't drink much. I have the good rest before surgery. And if I operate 70 cases, I always keep another power to operate another 10 cases, just in case with the patient has the complicated cases. I have a special 1 day to manage complicated cataracts such as subluxated cataract or the white macula cataract, very dense cataract, small pupil, which require the iris retractors. I set it on Wednesday. On Wednesday, I operate only 20-30 cases because one case of the surgery will take longer surgical time. So for another days, I operate 60-70 cases. Nowadays, patients come much earlier for the surgery in Japan, especially in Tokyo. I believe that the patient education is important. If the patient come late, the surgeon have to have a very hard time to manage the patient, and also the patient had a hard time for recovery. So if you have a chance to educate the patient, if the patient have any difficulty in vision, they should come to the hospital or clinic to have the surgery. If I have a chance to give my message, I would give my patient such a message.
Thank you, Professor. The next question is from Dr. Ing Leong Na. He said that it is a privilege to attend this excellent lecture and sharing by Professor Akahoshi. And he wants to ask where we can purchase the Cornell CCC 5.5mm marker or the magic marker. Thank you.
Those instruments, all these my instrument is designed and produced by ASICO, American Surgical Instrument Corporation. I believe there should be a distributor of ASICO in Indonesia. They can provide the instrument. You can also check the web ASICO, S-I-C-O, ASICO, or by net, and you will see my instrument there. I don't have any financial interest, but they have the very good quality of the instrument, and all my items using for my surgery is from ASICO now.
Akutia. Thank you so much, Professor. Now the question from France. If there is complication in very first surgery, how to encourage yourself to make the queue not stuck?
Yes, of course, in case with challenging cases such as in posterior polar cataract or a very dense cataract or the weak zonules, such in complicated cases, I set those cases on Wednesday. I don't operate many cases on Wednesday, maybe 20 or 30 cases. But most of the cases, not so challenging cases in my daily surgery, without any issues, 67 cases, 70 cases without any issues. In case with an posterior capsule rupture, what I always do is continue to do phaco. And in that situation, I will reduce the pressure down to 20 millimeter mercury and flow rate from 45 to 25. Very slow irrigation, as the nucleus is already pre-chopped. Even in such a situation, I can safely emulsify the nucleus. And then also with a very, very low pressure, 20 millimeter mercury, I will carefully remove the cortex and then implant the same single piece acrysop into the capsular back. I always use counter traction implantation technique, fill up the chamber with probisc and providing the counter force to the cartridge using a D cartridge, 6 millimeter acrysop can be implanted through 1.8. But in such a complicated situation, I will extend the incision up to 2.4 and the full cartridge is inserted into the anterior chamber and then gently inject the lens into the capsular back. And then I set the haptics at the proper position, and then I will wash out the probisc in the anterior chamber by myostat to constrict the pupil. I don't use an IA, just wash out the OVD from the anterior chamber and also at the same time make the pupil small. And then I will make one stitch on the incision. That is the way I manage the complication of the posterior capsule rupture.
The next question is still from Dr. Ing Leong No. He asks about, for a soft nucleus cataract, a gentle phaco to setting will aspirate with the minimal phaco energy. What is the rationale for using another pre-chopper?
Yes, nowadays in Tokyo, I had many, many cases of soft cataract grade 1 or at most grade 2. In such a case, I prefer to use a disc blade pre-chopper, round disc blade pre-chopper. There's no sharp edge. Psychologically, I can quite easily insert the pre-chopper into the nucleus. And even the nucleus is soft. I always pre-chop the nucleus before performing the phaco. But the issue of soft cataract is difficult to perform hydrodissection. So if the nucleus has a moderate hardness, I can pre-chop the, bisect the nucleus and then rotate the nucleus, and then I can pre-chop into four pieces. But for the soft cataract, it is difficult to rotate. In such a case, I just cut the nucleus half and this way, without rotating the nucleus, I cut the nucleus into four pieces and then perform phaco aspiration. At that time, I will almost not use an phaco, just using the vacuum, I can remove the soft cataract.
Thank you so much, Taka. The next question from Brazil. Why we do need to be efficient? Is there any correlation between phaco efficiency with carbon emission?
Because my patient is waiting usually 3 months and sometimes 6 months before surgery. There are many clinics and hospitals in Tokyo, but still many patients come to me. I have more than 1,200 doctors who don't operate, just see the patient.
all those doctors sent a patient to me. And also from the hospital or university hospital, 300 big general hospital and the university hospital patients referred to me. Why? The reason is that my quality of the surgery is so good. My incision size is small. My patient has no astigmatism after surgery because I always use a toric lens if the patient has indication. And there's no complications. And the patients are very happy after the surgery. If the patients are happy, those doctors who refer the patient is also happy. They send the referred patient again to me. From the university hospitals and also the general hospital, especially in this period of COVID-19, certain complicated cases is also referred to me. I manage every case, not only the easy soft case, but I always operate. I will never refuse any case. I operate any challenging cases and I can attain the good result thanks to the good equipment and also good technique of the phaco bridge. So I have many patients waiting for my surgery. So routinely I operate 60 cases without any issues, no complications. That is the reason I operate so many cases every day. It is not for financial reasons. I'm just an employee. I was working at the charity hospital of Mitsui Memorial Hospital for 26 years. And I'm working now in two clinics, but they are not my own clinic. I'm just an employee of the clinic.
Thank you, Professor. It's such an inspiring story. The next question is, Professor, you said you implant CTR in each and every case of multifocal or trifocal lens. Do you recognize any difference if you do not implant the CTR?
It depends on the ciliary zonules. If the patient have the weakened ciliary zonules, after many years, the lens might decentrate. So for the better centration of the multifocal lens, I routinely implant the CTR. And another benefit of the CTR is that once the lens was decentrated or the subluxated due to the weak zonules, it is quite easy to manage in such a case. Maybe 10 to 15 cases a year, I have such a subluxated or decentrated multifocal lenses. In such a case, the whole complex multifocal lens, capsule, and CTR is decentrated due to the weakened zonules. My policy is to use the same multifocal lens to fix at the original position. If there is the CTR, I can suture the CTR complex to the square quite easily. So even the multifocal toric lens, I can adjust the axis. So if the patient have the issue of the lens position after several years, I can save those patients. So I always implant CTR or multifocal cases.
Thank you so much, Professor. The question from Germany. When does efficiency become too much and tend to be harm entire surgery?
Could you repeat the question again?
From Germany, when does efficiency become too much and tend to be harm entire surgery?
Efficiency
too much.
It will not too much. I can finish the surgery earlier and our staff can go back home earlier. They should be happy.
Thank you so much.
Okay. The next question from Dr. Ramani Chandrasekara. Excuse me, Professor, can you decide with just slit examination itself which chopper you can use for the surgery?
Yes, currently, I used to use only two pre-choppers, combo pre-chopper for the soft cataract for the karate technique and the universal pre-chopper for the dense cataract for the counter pre-chopper technique. So I used only two pre-choppers. But nowadays, as I showed, I mainly use the disc pre-chopper for the soft cataract and the new generation combo pre-chopper or Vienna window pre-chopper for soft medium cataract. And for the medium hard nucleus, I use a combo 4 pre-chopper with a counter pre-chop technique. And for the very dense cataract, I use a sharp universal pre-choppers. I'll see all the patients before starting the surgery at every session, three sessions, but before starting surgery, I see the patient, and for the toric patient, I'll make a reference mark on the slit lamp, and also I check the nuclear density. But also, my microscope has a surgical slit. I use a Lumera microscope, and it has an option of the surgical slit. Under the table, I can make the slit lamp image of the patient. So I can judge the nuclear density, how deep the anterior chamber, how big the nucleus. I can quite easily recognize the case. So according to the nuclear density, I will choose appropriate pre-chopper, and I will choose nucleus sustained normal or the myopic long tip nuclear sustainer. So if it is possible to use a surgical slit, it will be a good option or to judge the nuclear density.
Thank you, Professor. And the next question is still from Dr. Ramani. He asked about why do you use IOP in myopic patients?
Because even though I use a 0.5% intracameral anesthesia, some myopic patient complained some pain during the phaco emulsification. So in such a case, I reduce the pressure. Usually I use 110 millimeter mercury for the normal cases. But in such a case, I use a myopic setting. The pressure is 70 or 80 millimeter mercury. Even though some patient complained some pain, so according to the situation of the patient, I may further reduce the pressure down to 30, 20 millimeter mercury. But if the pressure is low, it will take longer aspiration time. So it depends on the case. If the pressure is 70, 80, it will be a little bit longer phaco time, but the patient should be much comfortable. It depends on the patient response during the surgery.
Okay, thank you so much, Professor. The next question from UK. What kind of factors that we don't compromise in efficiency? IOL, OVD, phaco machine, what else, Professor?
For the efficiency? Efficiency.
Efficiency, we do not compromise.
Compromise.
Yeah.
Yes, for the efficiency, the priority is the quality of the surgery. I never compromise quality. For the efficiency, I use a sharp diamond blade rather than the steel blade, and also for the safety reasons, I use a special drape. And also for prevention of the corneal damage, I always routinely use the viscoelastic and Provis, two types of the viscoelastic material. And also for BSS, I give some antibiotics in the BSS solution to prevent the endophthalmitis. And what else? The key point is that the phaco pre-chop and harmonic phaco tip, very efficient, and burst mode, and preloaded intraocular lens using D cartridge and Royale injector. As I explained everything in my surgery, all these are connected to get the good result most efficiently.
This is from Dr. Anna Guschin. Firstly, season and appreciation for such a comprehensive lecture and update on the pre-chopper. And she has two a little bit long questions, so I will read it one by one. The first one, she would like to ask, with one operating room theater, but with two patients, how do you ensure the proper patients and lens identification or matching?
Yes, it is a very important point. Everything is prepared in advance. I have the complete surgical list as already shown in the presentation. And also I have the staffs who taking care of the medical record and also recording every cases. And also they are capturing the each step of the procedures by still pictures with the surgical record in the reference letter back to the referred doctors. And also the special staff taking care of the lens. And before setting the lens, the nurse and this technician confirm the lens power, patient name. And when the lens is set, the another two nurses confirm each other the lens is proper for the patient. And then when I implant the lens, the nurse standing by myself is confirming the lens patient name and lens power to the staff. And when I implant the lens, the staff and me will confirm the axis of the toric lens. There are 3-4 steps to confirm the proper lens is properly implanted to the patient. There are not double, there's 4 times or 5 times checking up to implant the lens.
Professor, her next question is, she saw that you have the case list at the entry point, but what is the checkpoint for the lens implant power?
Lens power?
What lens is the power. Checkpoint for the lens implant power?
Lens power is already shown in the list, and also they have the staffs have the another list, and each lens is prepared with the medical record and the lens. So, as I mentioned, they check the power and the name of the patient 4-5 times before actually implanting the lens.
Thank you, Professor. The next question from Tajikistan. Beyond preserve technique, what kind of technique do you suggest for us as efficient phaco technique?
Tajikistan, probably they should have the very dense cataract in that region of the country. I do recommend to pre-chop the nucleus into smaller pieces. Usually in soft cataract, I pre-chop the nucleus just for 4 pieces. But if they operate the nucleus dense cataract, I do recommend to pitch up into 6 or 8 small pieces and use enough amount of dispersive viscoelastic material such as the visco to prevent the cornea anterior damage. And also in such a dense cataract, I usually make the single plane incision in the cornea, but in such a case, I may use the 2-step incision for either sealing or the incision. And also, if the nucleus is so dense and if I use a lot of ultrasound energy, I may make the single stitch, 10 or 9 stitch to prevent the leakage of the incision after the surgery.
Okay. This is the next question, Prof, from Dr. Chandra Sekara. Do you have a posterior segment surgeon to address the nucleus drop in any case? And how often do you do a secondary IOL?
Yes, I have a good friend of the vitreoretinal regional surgeon to stand by my surgery. It is another hospital, but I may ask him to help for the dropping nucleus, maybe less than 5 cases a year among 8,000 over cases. Such as a dense posterior polar cataract or dense nucleus.
Well, the Rivasri, he's a vitrectomy surgeon. He has a lot of post-vitrectomy patients with a dense nuclear cataract. I operate his cataract a lot. So my policy of the, in case of the posterior capsule rupture, I try to manage to implant a single piece acrylisoft in the capsular back. But in case with a larger posterior capsule tear and it is not possible to implant single piece lens, I will use MA50BM. It is the 6.5 millimeter optic three piece acrylisoft lens. As my capsular lexis is 5.5, I will implant a lens, this 6.5 millimeter three piece lens with a haptics into the sulcus, and then I will capture the optic at the capsule lexis edge. So at, it is captured by the capsule lexis, normal vitreous will come into the anterior chamber, and the position, effective anterior chamber depth is the same even if it is, the haptic is placed into the sulcus, the postoperative refraction is the same, and there's no vitreous. The anterior chamber. In case I found some vitreous in the chamber, I just use a sponge and scissors to manage. I never use anterior vitreous cutter to manage the vitreous. In that way, thanks to the phaco bridge job and the power management, I seldom rupture the posterior capsule. But even if I have the complications, I will implant that the large acrylisoft in a good position and ask my friend to manage the posterior vitrectomy to radial nucleus or the cortex.
Okay.
Professor, someone asked, have you experienced repetitive stress injury of the wrist due to high volume surgery? Do you do any specific exercise or stretching to prevent that?
Yes, when I use the conventional phaco machines, Infinity or the Legacy, as my incision was very small, I need sufficient irrigation into the anterior chamber. I needed to hire the BSS bottle with an extension pole, and I also needed to lower the table as low as possible to get a sufficient irrigation through a small incision. So I needed to bend over the patient, and I had an issue of the back pain or neck pain. But fortunately, after I start to use a Centurion, it is an active fluidics. The soft BSS back is controlled by the machine to stabilize the anterior chamber. The chamber stability is very good even at the high table position. So I can, after Centurion, I can operate with a normal position. And also I have the good microscope of the Lumera. This is in a good position. Nowadays I have no issues of the neck or the back pain. I need to exercise. I realize it because I am getting old and I'm getting weight. So what I'm doing is running around the operating theaters.
Do you suggest a Chinese ball? Taka. No. Okay. Thank you, Taka. This is the question from Dr. Anna Goshin. What can be done if a patient requires general anesthesia? Do you do those kind of cases first?
Yeah, maybe one or two cases of mental retardation, very dense, difficult cases which cannot perform the local anesthesia, I may ask the general anesthesia. But nowadays, so far, I don't have any cases for the general anesthesia for cataract surgery. I have good staffs take care of the patient. If the patient moves around, she will hold patient ahead, and I will continue to talk with the patient. The patient had a high blood pressure. Our staff will grasp the patient's hand. The patient are so relaxed, and I seldom need general anesthesia. I never give the sedation for the patient. Just the oral anesthesia, I just continue to talk during the surgery. The patient is so relaxed. Always my staff holding the patient's hand, and they appreciate that. So I don't have the issues of the, I don't need general anesthesia in my surgery.
Thank you, Professor. Another question from Dr. Robinson. How often do you do bilateral phaco in the same day?
More than 95% of my cases are bilateral. Only 5% of the cases already operated another place, or the very young patient who had the enough accommodation and had the cataract only one eye, I will operate only that eye. If the patient had the good accommodation and there's no refractive changes, if the old patient, if the patient is old and don't have the accommodation, and also if the patient have the cataract, I perform the bilateral cataract surgery. As a result, 95% of my cases are bilateral.
Okay. I think he mean, how often do you do bilateral phaco in the same day?
Simultaneously.
Every day.
Every day.
All my cases, among 60, 70 cases, all my cases, 94% are bilateral.
Maybe this is the last question from Dr. Eti Darnella from Indonesia. Excuse me, Professor, what is the key point managed for the subcapsularis posterior cataract? Thank you.
Posterior polar cataract. Yes. In the posterior polar cataract, what I do is first for the incision, I will make two-step incision just in case of the complications. And then I will make the normal capsulorhexis. Usually I try to perform the cortical cleaving hydrodissection because I want to minimize the cortical removal after doing the phaco emulsification. But in case with the posterior polar cataract, I will hydrodelaminate the nucleus very, very gently. And then I will not rotate the nucleus. If the nucleus is not so dense, as I mentioned, I make the cut like this. And then after removing the nucleus, I will remove the epinucleus and the cortex at a very low pressure and flow rate. And also during the phaco emulsifications, I reduce the pressure down to 20 or 30 millimeter mercury, and also the flow rate 25 or 30 cc per minute. Gently and gently, I remove the nucleus, and at the last moment, I remove the cortex, also with a very low pressure. Sometimes some cortical remnant may remain on the posterior capsule in case of the posterior polar cataract, but I don't care. I just implant the lens and then finish the surgery with a low pressure. So sometimes I may make one stitch. I don't want to increase the pressure, one stitch. And then if I left some opacity on the posterior capsule, I will perform a young capsulotomy 1 month after the surgery. In that way, I will manage the posterior polar cataract.
Thank you, Professor. I believe this is our final question. Why you said previously that you do not like preloaded IOLs?
First, the cost. And the second, I need a D cartridge, small D cartridge. And to implant 6mm optic lens through 1.8, I need a special technique. I developed this technique in 2004, and I named it the counter-traction implantation technique. Incision size is 1.8 and my side port incision is 0.6. The key point is to keep a high pressure during inserting the lens. So for that purpose, I don't like the leakage of OVD through the side port. So my side port incision is 0.6. Keeping the high pressure, I inject enough amount of the probisc, and then through 1.8, even the smallest D cartridge nodes can never enter into the anterior capsule. Just the cartridge tip is attached on the incision, and providing the counterforce, I will use Royal injector. I never use the Monarch injector because Monarch injector is screw type. I need a counterforce to the injectors. So I developed the Royal single hand injector to implant the lens. The plastic injector is too weak, even it is with D cartridge to provide a sufficient counterforce. So my preference is stiff metal Royal injector with D cartridge and providing counterforce. In that way, I can implant 6 mm aprisop through 1.8. So one reason is this technical reason. And another reason is that the disposable lens is more expensive than non-disposable preloaded lens. So still I'm using non-loading preloaded lens. My nurses, scrub nurses are so trained, so good trained, they can set the lens properly in the cartridge under the magnifiers.
Sorry, Professor. One last question from Dr. Anna Dushin. What is your preoperative analgesic or anesthesia of choice, and do you use music in the OR for its calming effect on the for the patient?
Yeah, for the anesthesia, we just use the benoxynate, oxybuprocaine, 3-4 times before surgery. And then I also use intracameral anesthesia, 0.5% preservative-free lidocaine intracamerally, small amount. That's all. I never have the music in the operating theater because I always hear the sound of the PEEK machine to know the vacuum pressure, and always I hear the breathing of the patient. Under the drape, I want to know how the patient is. I check the oxygen saturation, the pressure, or the EKG monitor. But if the patient is anxious, she may breathe roughly. So I'm hearing the patient breathe and also talking. I never listen to the music. And also the patient don't want the music. What is important for the staff is that our staff will hold her hand. Just put the hand on the patient's hand. That is good sedation for the patient.
Thank you, Professor. This is from Dr. Wen Ji At Ang. She said, wonderful and very informative talk. And she has a question. Do you screen patients preoperatively for COVID-19? Thank you.
Yes, if the patient have the fever or some symptom, we have the kit to test the COVID-19 antigen and antibody also. But most of the patients have the systemic disease, and also we have the refer to those, we get the information, preoperative information for the medical doctors about how the systemic conditions. And currently we have no case of the COVID-19 in our clinic. Compared to with the last 2019, the number of the cases was about 8% less. The cases of the of my surgery is about 7.9% less than previous year due to the COVID-19. But that is due to the more complicated cases from university hospital or the general hospitals refer to our clinic to manage those cases, because in the university hospital, they cannot manage the cataract due to the COVID patient. Fortunately, we don't have the, any case of the COVID patient in our clinic.
Okay, amazing. More than 20 questions have been answered by our maestro at this very moment. Great audience, great speaker, so awesome. Field of ophthalmologists, that's all folks. We learned a lot this moment. This is very powerful knowledge to improve our skill in cataract surgeries. We all can play this lecture again and again on YouTube. We record this for you just for learning more. Please pay attention to details and do practice a lot and do more practice, because practice makes perfect and practice makes impossible possible. Thank you, SMEC Group. Thank you, ED, Perdami Sumut. Thank you, all committee. And thank you, Dea. Thank you. And to our maestro, Dr. Takayuki Akaoshi, please send our regards to your family. Domo arigato, sensei. Thank you so much, Taka.
Thank you very much. See you again. Please take care.
Bye.
Thank you for this memorable lecture and useful information you have shared with us this afternoon in Japan. That was wonderful. Thank you so much. Arigato gozaimasu, Professor. Thank you.
Thank you.
And everyone, see you on the next 1 hour with the maestro. Thank you, my amazing friend from all around the world. Thank you for bringing peace and tranquility on earth after 8 episodes. Now I know that you are absolutely the best in the world. Stay healthy, stay wealthy, and stay happy, everybody. You all rock. Thank you so much. Happy equinox. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And then Vira, Space Flower, student of astrophysics from UC Berkeley. Now the time is yours. Sayonara.
All right, everyone. So as you may have already noticed, we have arrived at the end of this webinar. So we really hope that our webinar today have enriched our knowledge about these really important topics. And once again, we would like to say thank you to the Sabang Merauke Eye Center and also to the Indonesian Ophthalmologist Association North Sumatra Branch, and also to the Indonesian Doctor Association Medan Branch for supporting this event. So once again, we would like to express our deepest, deepest gratitude to Professor Takayuki Akaoshi for becoming a speaker and for the amazing lecture that he gave us today. So, domo arigato gozaimashita, sensei. And then as well to Dr. Gede Pardianto as our moderator, and also for Dr. Andrea Silitonga as a co-moderator. And of course, thank you to all the participants for your enthusiasm throughout this webinar. And then we would like to inform you that your e-certificate will be sent to your email after this webinar. And also we'd like to give you a reminder to check your spam folder, because sometimes they get sent there, not to your main inbox. So just make sure to check your spam folder to see your e-certificate, because sometimes that happens. So with that, my name is Vera, astrophysics student from UC Berkeley. As today's master of ceremony, I'd like to say thank you so much for your attention and your attendance to our webinar today. And we will see you again at another 1 hour with the master webinar series, which would be next month. And this time it's actually not going to be too far away from today. It's actually less than 2 weeks away. It will be on April 2nd, 2021. And the speaker would be Dr. Firna Dwi Oktariana with the topic Indonesian-made glaucoma drainage implant. And we have sent the link for registration for that webinar in the email that contains your certificate as well. And we've also like kept sharing the registration link in the chat throughout this whole webinar. So make sure you check that out and register for the next episode of this webinar series. And yeah, so that you are always updated with the latest knowledge and innovations in the field of ophthalmology. And once again, thank you so much. And we wish you a wonderful day and happy spring equinox. Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye. Thank you, Fira.
Udah.
Ayo foto sebelum aku meriksa pasien. Ayo Bu. Foto ini. Ayo Bi, sini Bi.
We're so excited to tell you that at this moment, we have near 1,400 participants from 85 countries and 6 continents around the world.
That today, we have near 1,000 participants from 53 countries across 6 continents.
We are so excited to inform you that at this very moment, we have more than 1,000 participants from 76 countries across 6 continents.
And today, we are so excited to inform you that at this very moment, we have more than 1,100 participants from 71 countries across 6 continents streaming from both Zoom and YouTube.
Time is yours. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, lift off. Let's go.
Thank you very much. It's been a great pleasure to speak with you. Nice to meet you over Zoom. It's interesting that we meet people now across the world all the time.
And lift off. Give applause to Amar Agarwal.
Thank you very, very much, first of all, to entire Indonesia and also to all the 1,400 delegates watching from 85 countries.
Oh, applause. Godspeed, my jersey.
Thank you very much. That was extremely kind invitation, and of course, a very beautiful
thing for them.
Thank you very much.
Time is yours. Leave off. Go ahead, please.
Thank you very much. First of all, I want to thank Gede, Parlianto, and all Indonesian ophthalmologists that were being so kind to invite me.
Thank you so much, really, for organizing something like this, because it really kind of opens up so many channels of education.
Thank you very much for the very kind invitation and how many international respondents you have. You obviously, the whole world is watching Indonesia.
4, 3, 2, 1, time is yours. Leave off. Here we go, Devin. It is showtime.
Thank you all, and everyone be safe, and I hope all of you around the world think how many people you reach with this. It's great. It's a great service. Anyway, you're doing a great job, and my congratulations to everyone.
I'm not afraid.
世界思い漁るよ。